Normally, the ground crew will start the engine, but every pilot should be familiar with the starting routine. With ignition off, the prop is pulled through three or four times to clear the cylinders. A cartridge is placed in the breech of the starter, which is reached through a door in the accessory compartment. Cowl flaps open. Alternate air control in. Prop control in low pitch, high RPM. Blower in neutral. Mixture control in idle cutoff. With fuel selector on reserve, the booster pump is used to raise fuel pressure to about 17 pounds. The engine is primed for 4 to 7 seconds, depending on whether it is warm or cold. Moving the mixture control forward and back aids in priming the induction system. And the cartridge starter, energized by means of the switch on the distribution panel, must be held on until the engine runs smoothly, as it also controls the ignition booster. As soon as the engine starts, the mixture control is moved to automatic rich. Do this slowly to avoid flooding the engine, and adjust the throttle to give not more than 750 RPM. The wings are spread by moving the hydraulic control lever to the spread position. When the wings are fully extended, the small doors at the wing joints close, indicating that the hinge pins are in position. Then these hinge pins are locked by pulling up on the D handle and turning it clockwise. This will silence the warning horn, which blows throughout the last 7 degrees of the wing spreading operation. As you go up in horsepower and performance, it becomes more and more important that you take nothing for granted. You must know all about the controls, operating mechanisms, and power plants. There are more than the usual number of hydraulic devices, and you need to be familiar with their functions. The cowl flaps have no indicator, but you can see their position from your seat. The intercooler flap position can be seen on the indicator because the position is impossible to see from the cockpit. The same is true of the oil cooler flap. The three-point attitude of the airplane on the deck will vary depending on whether the tail wheel has a pneumatic tire or one of solid rubber. The latter brings the tail somewhat closer to the deck, but with the pneumatic tail wheel, the airplane rests at approximately the stalling angle of attack. The shocks are removed, brakes released, and you're ready to taxi away from the line. You'll probably have a tendency to use too much throttle. The brakes are very effective, but don't attempt a long taxi requiring a lot of braking. You can't get rid of the heat. And as you can see, taxiing is necessarily slow because of the necessity of S-turning to get better forward vision. Early models of the F4U are equipped with a check-off list switch instrument. When this switch is turned to takeoff position, the warning horn for the landing gear will not blow. Later models, however, do not have a check-off switch instrument. The check-off lists for taking off and for landing are placed on separate plates mounted on the instrument panel. Prior to takeoff, you'll check the following. Wings and lock. Arresting hook control, up. Otherwise, you will be unable to retract the wheels after takeoff. Fuel tank selector on reserve. A 50-gallon standpipe in the main tank. The main tank is pressurized and self-sealing. It has a total capacity of 230 gallons and is the only tank to have a quantity gauge. You have a 57-gallon tank in each of the outer wing panels for use in cruising. They're equipped with a CO2 vapor dilution system, but are not pressurized. Mixture control is automatic rich and blower in neutral. Propeller control down. for maximum RPM on the takeoff. Cowl flaps two-thirds open. Intercooler closed. Oil cooler open as required. Set the rudder tab 6 degrees right. Aileron 6 degrees right wing down. Elevator tab 1 degree nose up. These settings compensate for left wing heaviness due to engine torque. Alternate air control in. Here's the flap control. But we have a good runway at this field, and this first takeoff will be with flaps up. When the oil temperature is above 40 degrees and cylinder head temperatures are above 120 degrees, open up to about 30 inches in full low pitch. Check your mags fairly quickly. The drop shouldn't exceed 100 RPM and is usually between 50 and 75. Freedom from vibration is a good indication that the big engine is functioning properly. When you've gone through the checkoff list and you're all set, lock the tail wheel and take off into the wind. Ease the throttle forward and approach full power in step. Notice that the pilot did not pull the airplane off. He avoided a stall position by flying off the field. She'll take off very nicely with 45 inches and 2,700 RPM. But you can pull up to 53 and one-half inches if you need it. Don't take off until you have enough speed. If you do, you'll have some deficiency of aileron control and left wing heaviness. After reducing throttle and RPM to the desired setting, pick up the wheel. Let's go back and make a takeoff with the flaps down. For a carrier takeoff, you'll use about half flap, 20 to 30 degrees, with full power, while holding the plane with the brakes. Extreme caution must be observed to hold the tail down with the stick to prevent nosing over and digging the prop into the deck. With your flaps down, tab settings are even more important to reduce the force needed to maintain your run and takeoff path. 6 degrees nose right, 6 degrees right wing down, and about a degree nose up. After you have retracted the landing gear, when you have 110 to 120 knots, bring the flaps up in easy stages, about 10 degrees at a time. This way you can control a flap failure and you won't lose altitude. You can maintain your altitude and climb. You can use your full takeoff power for a military climb of about 3,000 feet per minute. But after 5 minutes, you must throttle back to normal rated power for continuous operation. 43.5 inches at 2,550 RPM in neutral blower. With this power setting, your rate of climb will be about 2,000 feet per minute at a best climbing speed of 125 knots. At about 8,000 feet, you will have lost about 3 inches of manifold pressure. If you want to continue the same rate of climb, you must throttle back 3 to 4 inches of mercury, open the intercooler flap, and shift to low blower. Increase your manifold pressure to 47.5 inches and keep climbing. You can carry this power up to 13,500 feet. Where again, you will note a loss of about 3 inches of mercury. If you want more altitude, throttle back to lose an additional 3 or 4 inches and shift to high blower, followed by 48 inches of manifold pressure. Always keep your intercooler flaps about one-half open when using low or high blower to maintain intake mixture temperatures within safe limits. A red warning light will indicate excessive temperatures and warn you to reduce power. Open the intercooler flaps wide and, if necessary, shift to a lower blower. Use automatic ridge for all your climbing and maneuvering. You're using a lot of power, and if your mixture is not rich enough, there's danger of burning up the engine. Use a partial power climb if the tactical situation permits. Around 135 knots is about the best indicated speed. The cylinder heads have a rather high limitation, 260 degrees, and this should be used with caution. Oil temperature shouldn't exceed 95 degrees.